I am Bill Courtwright with Living Right with Bill Courtwright, and this is the Stress Mastery Podcast, where we take you from the science to the spirituality of stress mastery.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Stress Mastery Podcast. I am Bill Courtwright, and I am here with the super millennial, David Barreto. Big Dave, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
So this week, our topic is freedom. And on Millennial Monday, David talked about what millennials look for when creating freedom. Our health huddles this week was changing our health focus. Wednesday's Meeting of the Minds, we talked on becoming free. On Connection Thursday, we talked about finding freedom through relationships. And today, we will continue our book study of Dr. Wayne Dyer's Wishes Fulfilled. Before we get started, it is Linda's Super Bowls today. You know that, right?
Yes, it is.
Nobody shops as well as my wife, Linda, shops. She is a pro. There are professionals. She's a pro.
She is definitely a pro.
This is her Super Bowl. So we have several announcements. Go ahead, David.
So I will keep it shorter and sweeter than yesterday's 25 minutes worth of announcements. Because the link to the email that you would get with all the details is actually going to be below. So you click there and see all the details in full detail right there. But we are doing Black Friday deals on our wellness coaching. It is $5.99, which is 25% off. And this includes the consult setup, daily accountability, pause plan lifestyle, personal program for you, weekly one-on-one coaching supplements, and some of the personal development that we use to create the permanent life shift in your life.
Sure.
We also are running early bird Black Friday deals for our 2020 event, the Truths of Stress Mastery Retreat. The tickets are $4.99 and they will be going up to $7.99. So it is a significant discount right now. The event is July 31st to August 1st, Unity Village, Kansas City, Missouri.
So usually your Millennial Mondays are like 15 minutes, right?
Yes.
Can I be invited into this Millennial Monday and then we'll go into a little bit more detail on both these subjects?
Yeah, that actually
you okay
really
with
good.
That?
Yeah, we can do a lot
I just,
more details.
And what I just want to go into is I want you guys to understand the significance of this retreat that we're doing. It is going to be incredible. And I want you, if you've never done coaching with us, to understand the difference between our wellness coaching and other programs like this, because there's a big difference. And we can't take all that time on our episodes because our episodes will be 50 minutes, right?
Yeah.
So if I can be invited as a special guest for Millennial Monday, I will give a quick rundown on everything else and then I'll leave.
I got to talk to the boss, but I think I can make it happen.
You can? Talk to that guy, all right? That guy, that super millennial. The guy with the beard, super millennial that's doing it. So I'm excited though, by the way. I'm very excited. We have a lot of announcements next year. Our collaboration with Unity is bigger than I can explain what we're going to be doing and everything else. And the growth process of where we're taking Stress Mastery, that event's going to be amazing. It really is going to be amazing. And you've got to see where we're having it. So we're going to send out some emails, but we also send out some pictures. Can we send out some videos and pictures and stuff like that of the grounds? And
yeah, you guys would have got an email today with a lot of the descriptions. It's going to have... it's going to answer, like Bill said, if we did it all in one show, it's going to be a 50-minute show. But we are going to send out periodic emails on it. If you guys want to make sure that you don't miss them, you can go to the website and just subscribe. Mm-hmm. You'll get those. And like I said, the price on that is going to periodically increase. So right now, it's significant.
Yeah, and we want to get...
There's only 300 tickets.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. Because once it's done, it's done, yeah. Right? And only 30 VIPs. And we'll talk about that next week, too. All right, so we are in chapter 5 of the book, and it's called The Second Wishes Fulfilled Foundation, Live from the End. So Wayne starts out, in the presence of him whom he believed God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which does not exist as though they did. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. You might find that this second foundation of wishes fulfilled life is most troublesome and unconventional idea that you tackle. If you find that this is true for you, I encourage you to rustle up the determination you are capable of. You are going to begin retraining your imagination so that it accepts the idea that anything placed there isn't for a future experience, but represent your reality right here, right now. You are being asked to put your five senses into the lockbox so that they can't persuade you that you are ignoring what they perceive as reality. You are stepping into a new dimension. I feel like I should have the music from So you're stepping into a new dimension, the unaccustomed reality that St. Paul speaks of in his letters to the people of Rome in Romans chapter 4, verse 17, cited above. Keep in mind a fundamental axiom of this book, the strong knowing I described in chapter 3 and stressed throughout the book. We are all God. It is not written in your law, I said. You are gods. John chapter 7, verse 34, was the response to Jesus when he was about to be stoned. For a good work, we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, and because you, being a man, make yourself God. John chapter 10, verse 33, and I quote this to remind you that it is not me, some crazy 21st century writer, saying these words. They are directly out of the scriptures. Now, simply review the line St. Paul speaks in Romans chapter 4, verse 17. And calls those things which do not exist as though they did. This is how God works, your imagination. When aligned to the highest principles of your highest self, is God at work. You can make your imagination a place where you absolutely call things as you insist that they be, even though they may not have appeared in the third dimension as reported by your five senses. This is where you must learn to trust, think, and live from rather than the anticipation of, hence the title of this chapter, Live from the End. As I sit here writing, there's a book with a beautiful jacket taped around it. The jacket is exactly the same cover of the book you are now reading, titled Wishes Fulfilled. I'm only one third the way through the actual writing of this book, yet I see the completed book every day when I approach my sacred writing space. This is a practice I've maintained for many years. And as I'm in the process of writing, I see the finished book every day, both in my imagination and in the symbolic representation. I do the same thing. I always make the cover of the book first. Sometimes I change the cover. But like, you've all seen the cover, right? The eye? That's the cover of the book. How long have I had that? For quite a while.
That ain't changing.
Yeah, that's not changing, right? So Wayne continues. My imagination is where my thoughts are and the thoughts of God. And thus, I am God creating what I know is already present. I am calling that which does not exist as though it did. Knowing and feeling this means nothing can dissuade you from this creative force in my imagination. There's no fear about completing some awesome undertaking of writing a book. It's already complete in my mind. I simply allow the energy to flow into me and through my heart and onto the pages. So on this part, he talked. Anything you want to add to that?
No, I like that a lot. And I use the same thing, even with not business related or anything super demanding, like with my car and stuff. As funny as it sounds, I use Photoshop to create these little, you know, renditions of what I expect something to be. And it's one way to create my imagination to bring it out to something more physical. And even in a business thing, we call it crystallization. It's making a physical form of something that you want to come to life.
I'll tell you, when I was bodybuilding, that's one of the first lessons I learned from Schwarzenegger. And I actually, do you remember the bodybuilder Rich Kaspari? Mm-hmm. So my physique is exactly like Rich Kaspari's. We're the same height. We had the same look. If you look at the physiques, they're very similar. What I did when I started bodybuilding, obviously I wasn't Rich Kaspari, right? This guy was second in Olympia. But I took my head and I put it on his body and I would look at that when I woke up and I would look at it before I go to bed. So I was going through some papers some years later and I found that picture. And I remember I even created the same flaws. You know, so if you look at my pictures, they match just about with those pictures. I never reached that level. He was fantastic, but my physique was exactly like that.
I would love to see the Bill Courtright picture on.
It's got to be somewhere. You know what? I don't know if I lost that in a hurricane or what, but I can remember finding years later. But that's how powerful the imagination is. I could see it. And then what I would do in bodybuilding is I would actually take pictures of each body part. And kind of look at each body part and how I wanted to visualize it. So if I had weakness, then I would try to bring that weakness up, whatever I was working on. So he continues here, and the title is called The Power of Your Imagination. Figuratively, tattoo these words of Neville onto your forehead. Figuratively, David. All right? In other words, memorize them and repeat them to yourself every time you look into the mirror. Neville says, disregard appearances, conditions, and in fact, all evidence of your senses that deny the fulfillment of your desire. Rest in the assumption that you're already what you want to be. For in the determined assumption, you and your infinite being are merged in creative unity. And with your infinite being, God, all things are possible. God never fails. And so Wayne says, your concept of yourself is being replaced by a new concept of yourself. A new self-concept begins with you placing it in your imagination and living from this new perspective. You can count on your five senses to attempt to convince you that you should pay homage only to them and treat your imagination as unimportant and illusionary. But that doesn't mean that you have to allow them to usurp your concept of yourself. Who's doing that? Your ego, right? Trying to pull you out. So right now, in this moment, you can practice this. Say aloud to yourself, by placing new I ams into my imagination, my future dream is a present fact. Repeat the statement a few times. Can you feel your ego resisting? Which of your five senses is most adamantly annoyed? Notice and repeat. This new concept of yourself as God, or at least the spark of God, asks you to think like God. Who calls those things which do not exist as though they did? Here you are creating an ideal of what you want to be and assuming that you're already that person. This is what Neville calls the law of assumption. And he states empathetically, if this assumption is persisted in until it becomes your dominant feeling, the attainment of your ideal is inevitable. So let Neville's words guide you. Therefore, to incarnate a new and greater value of yourself, you must assume that you already are what you want to be and then live by faith in this assumption, which is not yet incarnate in the body of your life, in confidence that this new value or state of consciousness will become incarnated through your absolute vitality to the assumption that you are that which you desire to be. And so Wayne continues, this is a total transformation of your entire being. Within your imagination, you can conceive thoughts of what you want as already here, prior to their birth in the form of the sensory world. This means that your thoughts aren't along the lines of, I will be, I hope it works out, I'm praying for good results. Instead, you say to yourself, I am, acknowledging the I am presence as God dwelling in me. You've already discovered that different bodies you have occupied throughout your life so far no longer exist in your senses to experience. Now you can choose to consciously participate in this non-sensory supreme reality, your imagination, where you assume your future dream to be a present fact and live from the new awareness. This isn't pretending or fooling yourself. It is inviting your spirit rather than your physical form to generate your creative essence of your reality. It's what it means to transform your life. The word transformation has the word form right smack in the middle, preceded by trance, meaning going beyond form. Live from the space that will indeed take you way beyond the limits of your seemingly limited life. Explore imagination, which is the source of all being or physical reality. Anything you want to touch on that, David?
Yeah, that's a big thing. I think he kind of touched it in like the scripture aspect of it, but it's the live by faith and not by sight thing. That's how everything is created that we have.
Everything you see was an idea. Yeah. Everything you see in your reality. This is why this is not some hocus pocus. This is fact. This is the way things work. And so he continues. And the title is Moving from I Am Not to I Am. Throughout life, you've been thorough. You've been through conditioning process that created a mindset overflowing with I am nots. As a school child with less than satisfactory grade on your report card, you thought to yourself, I am not smart. You place anywhere other than number one and you say, I am not talented. You feel criticized and believe that I am not so good. You look in the mirror and compare yourself to a glamorous movie idol or homecoming queen and tell yourself, I am not attractive. Your relationship fractures and you think I am unloved or I am unworthy. These and many more like them are repeated throughout the development years into adulthood and become your core defining self-concept. Overcoming this I am mentality begins with trusting your inner world of spirit. There are no boundaries restricting your inner world, but your worldview and your self-concept in the outer world are defined by your five senses. The outer world is always changing, which by our previous definition means it is not real. This awareness could lead you to experiencing a majestic wake-up call right here and right now. So how does it feel to realize that most of what you believe about yourself and your imagination is based on an illusion, a well-intentioned illusion handed to you by people in bodies that no longer exist in time that has passed? What do you think of that? That's the history, the agreements, right, that we talk about here. So much of your self-concept is fiction based on the beliefs that are untrue and contain no truth in them when you were first exposed to them. This was detailed by Anita Morjani, who had a near-death experience and challenged all her previous self-concepts about who and what she was. Her story illustrates that there's another dimension where you can become one with God and create miracles in your everyday life. So Anita had Hodgkin's lymphoma throughout her body. Her organs were shutting down and she was told she had less than 36 hours to live. She shared her near-death experience on the Research Foundation. It's called neardeath.org. She relates, I actually crossed over to another dimension where I was engulfed by a total feeling of love. I also experienced extreme clarity of why I had the cancer, why I had come into this life in the first place, what role everyone in my family played in my life in the grand scheme of things, and generally how life works. While in her near-death experience state, Anita was shown that everything going on in our lives is dependent on this energy around us and created by us. Nothing is solid. We are the creators of our surroundings and life conditions, depending on how we use this energy. Our physical bodies become sick because of the energetic level at which we live. As Anita reports, I realized that I went back and it would be with a very, let me make sure I have this right. I realized that if I went back, it would be with a very healthy energy. Then the physical body would catch up the energetic conditions very quickly and permanently. I was given the understanding that this applies to anything, not only illnesses. Anita was given the opportunity to return to her cancer-ravaged body. Astoundingly, 4 days later, her near-death experience, her body showed almost no signs of cancer. Now, this is documented, by the way, because I looked it up, right? Mm-hmm. Years ago, I looked it up when I read the book. She was actually given hours to live. And they have all the medical records. So this isn't something she made up, right? And so when she came back, she, and this is Wayne saying this, essentially this woman discovered the I Am God lesson of this book, as well as the great message of Jesus that I've detailed in the previous chapters. Basically, she came back and the cancer was completely gone. She changed it. Within 4 days, it was gone. Now, what do doctors say about that? How can you be a doctor and a scientist and watch this happen and not listen to her, right? Mm-hmm. You want to talk on that?
No, I think as like a doctor or scientist, that's why you do it, you know, because there's so much more
there's
that you don't
so
understand.
So much. The moment you think you know, if you go to the doctor with the blood work and they say, why would you order those? It's stupid. You don't need those tests. And we hear it all the time, right? That poor doctor is done. They are no longer in their aim to explore and expand. They are now in resist and restrict. And so they're done. That's what their life will be. You know, do you know that the number one suicides are now doctors? I don't, we'll get into that. It's another whole show. But I was shocked. I read this recently. So he continues. I'm sorry I got off track, people. Anita reported that she experienced a profound awareness that everything and everyone are interconnected and there is no separation. All she had to do to heal her physical body was to merge into God consciousness and be perfect love. We talked about it yesterday, right? I felt one with everything. I felt a connection with every living thing. And it felt like the whole universe is within me. She reports that time and space felt very different in that dimension. It doesn't feel linear like it does here. It felt like everything was happening simultaneously. So the world that Anita experienced while in her near-death experience is also your world. It requires making a shift to the true understanding of what the words I am signify to you. Live from the perspective that all things are possible, planted firmly in the depths of your imagination. The more you believe in your own divine nature, the more it starts to become real for you. Living from I am God awareness necessitates knowing that you are one with the transcendent unconditional love. This awareness attracts to your life everything that confirms this belief about yourself. Here you are ignoring what your senses preach to you. And after the words, I am, you are placing the words, magnificent. Remember these words that Jesus spoke. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Your I am for this is simply, I am love. Live from this awareness rather than the expectation that someday you'll arrive there. So he continues, and this line is your reconstructed I ams. Run through as large an inventory as you can of the things that you would like to define your life. Then make the shift in your imagination from an I am not or I am hoping to become to I am. You want what follows I am to be congruent with your highest self, which is God. Beginning with your inner dialogue, simply change the words and define your concept of yourself. Don't discuss what you're doing because involving others in your I ams invites their egos to assert its self-importance. Redefine your self-concept by choosing the words that you opt to place into your imagination. Try this rewording of your inner world as the beginning step to assessing and the assistance of your higher self and fulfilling your desires. In the book of Joel, the Lord's advice is in harmony with the I'm writing in this chapter. Let the weak say, I am strong. Joel chapter 3, verse 10. It truly is as simple as these seven words from the Bible. Advice. If you say, I am weak, you defile the name of God, and that is your highest self. How is it possible for a creative source of the universe, the source energy responsible for creating worlds, to say, I am weak? Instead of, I am incapable of getting this job, shift to, I am capable. Similarly, replace proclamations of, I am not able to live in peace with, I am peace. I am lucky and love is replaced by I am love. I am unworthy of happiness becomes I am happiness. The words I am, which you consistently use to define who you are and what you are capable of, are holy expressions of the name of God and the highest aspect of yourself. So expanding your inner presence. It is impossible for me to overstate the significance of using these two words of I am. Here are a few examples. Addictions. Affirm, I am sober, I am perfectly healthy. Stuttering, affirm, I am in perfect command of my speech. Poverty, affirm, I am prosperous. Illness, affirm, I am well, I am perfect health. Laziness, affirm. I am in possession of unlimited energy. Seeking love, affirm. I am love. I am in loving relationship. Intellectually weak, affirm. I am a genius. You might be thinking that this is all self-delusion, and just saying I am doesn't make it so. It's probably natural to feel skeptical if you believe that what your senses tell you is your only reality. The scriptures offer some words that may help you overcome your cynical viewpoint. The opening words in the book of John in the New Testament are, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John chapter 1, verse 1. 13 verses later, there is a phrase, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." John chapter 1, verse 14. So, here are three suggestions that Wayne gives us to talk about this, and then we'll discuss this a little bit. Number one, commit yourself to your own magnificence. Every time you look in the mirror, remind yourself of what stares back at you is not ever-changing body, but an invisibleness that is truly your highest self. Affirm, I am love. I am God. I am worthy. I am infinite. Silently and out loud, and do this frequently so it eventually becomes your inner mantra. Number two, fearlessly place I ams into your imagination. Recognize that previously your false self, your ego, would never allow this expansion of your awareness. Ignore three-dimensional evidence that has defined your existence up to now. Enter into a higher fourth dimension that allows for the primary teachings of Jesus the Christ. Excuse me. With God, all things are possible. Your imagination is yours. You are free to place anything in there at your discretion. I am talented. I am heroic. I am ecstatically happy. I am wealthy beyond words. I am content. I am God. Be fearless and let these ideals be your reality. And number three, take this advice from the I Am discourses. Decide what you want to do or become, and then, ignoring any and all interference, repeatedly say, I am the presence doing it. Treat this as your calling to love and adore your own mighty I Am presence, so that it always anchors and fortifies you. Every time you use the words I am with anything, you are calling in the divine power to do whatever you are proclaiming. So that ends that chapter. Next week, we'll go into chapter 6. The third wish is fulfilled foundation is feeling it. So, I will tell you, and yesterday was day one for my new year, and if you're in a community and you go in to module 3 and you go to higher goal setting and you do that process, that process ends with you taking your clarity of what you want from the head and placing it into the imagination of the heart. And I take you right through that, and then I give you what's called the 8 technique that takes you to the end for your visualization. What Wayne is teaching is truth. This is truth. David just said it a few minutes ago. Everything you see right now in your awareness at one time was a thought. And everything you want to be starts with a thought. And you got to manifest that thought by creating the proper I ams. David, you want to add anything there?
The one thing I would say, and surprisingly, it's actually a quote that I read, and it's from the Joker, surprisingly or not, and it says, "The reason why I hate mirrors is because what you see is the reflection of what everybody else sees of you and not what's inside of you." And I thought that was like exactly what this is. Just because you see yourself, you believe that that's what you are. And that's just the made up of what you think everyone else sees you as. Not a single person on this planet sees you the same way, right? And that's how you have to see yourself the same way. You have to see yourself within in a specific way. And that's so the unseen, right? Part of it.
I was working with a client, right? And this client is having some issues with business, right? And he's talking about how it's not his fault, that this person didn't pay and this did this and did this. And he's creating a victim story. He doesn't understand that when you're saying and blaming other people for your life circumstances, you are saying that you are a victim.
Yeah.
And you are creating everything in your life. And so you have to understand it. So the woman that had cancer, she created that in her life. And there was actually was a purpose behind it. So when you read about it, it's pretty amazing how she saw it. And she also can heal herself in her life, right? So we are never a victim. Never. We create that. So you can consciously create what you want. This is your year, people. And I'm telling you, those that are coming to the event in at Unity Village, we will be getting deep into these things. This is something we're really going to get into. When you leave there, your blueprint's going to be set. Because we are going to set your I am's. We're going to teach you how to visualize. We're going to teach you how to meditate. We're going to teach you how to connect to your imagination. Because it's all about head, heart, and hand. And when we talk about that, what is that? The heart's superpower is your imagination. And when you live from heart, you live from love and freedom that we talked about this week.
And then hopefully one of you guys can teach me how to golf because I suck.
Well, I'll take you out there. You know, I'm a good golfer, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, hey, I'm telling you, it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm excited about this. I'm excited about all the, we're going to be speaking in the churches all throughout the year. So we're going to meet people all over the country, right?
Yeah, what you see in July was once unseen.
Yep.
Right?
And what you come in, get ready, because it's going to rock. The thing is, people, I'm going to tell you this. This thing's going to, if you look at Unity, they have over 2 million people, and they're marketing this event, correct?
Yeah.
So with that being said, this event will sell out. Right?
Yeah, for sure.
Did you just see God talk to us? What the heck was that? The lights flicker?
Thank God we're on a laptop.
God, right? God's talking to us right now. You saw that?
Yeah.
And the weather's perfect, so I don't know what that was. Well, we're looking around. We hear dogs. We see lights. What is that? Wow, there's some crazy stuff. That's it for today's show. Let's get out of here before we blow up. Our mission here is to create a shift in the planet. You can join us on this mission by simply... like, share, and subscribe. Those links are right below the show. As always, until next time, stay inspired.